let's get going. Well, welcome to Proud to be a Noob, How to Make the Most of Your First OpenStack Summit. Truly the hottest panel at the summit, for warmth. I'm your host, Heidi Joy Tretheway. I am new to the OpenStack Foundation, and in fact, the last time I was at a summit in Vancouver, I was actually at the summit interviewing with the foundation. So I'm brand new, and so that's why I brought together this panel of lovely people who are not brand new and have a lot more to offer and share about how to make the most of your first summit. So I am going to, first of all, ask you to please participate with us and introduce yourself to someone you do not already know who is in this room. So that means stop, pause, pay no attention to me, and please introduce yourself to someone you don't already know.
That's classified.
Okay, and
classified.
I'm gonna give you one more instruction. Don't go back to your seat just yet. One more instruction is I want you to tell this person that you're meeting something you are passionate about and find out about something that they love. So I want you to ask one more question beyond who are you? Who are you with? Please find that out. Okay, in 60 seconds, I'm gonna ask you a question about the person you just met. So make it good, make the rest of your introduction good. I want you to find out something that the person you're meeting is passionate about. Tell them something about you that you are passionate about. 60 more seconds, we have a few gentlemen coming in. Come on in and take a seat, and now I'm going to interrupt y'all. And I'll bring your attention back to the front of the room, if I may. See, like, this is such a cool group that we can't stop talking to each other. Right? Okay, so what I wanted to hear from you is, would you tell me something that the person you just met is passionate about? And I'd like you to shout it out and then I'll repeat it just so I don't run around the room with a microphone. So tell me something that you just heard that someone's passionate about. First baby. What else?
Cycling.
What else?
Horseback riding.
Ooh, what else? So one more time. Nice, nice. What else are we passionate about in this room? Sorry?
Linux.
Good, good choices. What else?
Violin.
What else? The cloud. That's good. You were in the right place. So my point in asking the question is just to give you an opportunity to think beyond, hi, who are you, where are you from, and then kind of conversation stops, or sometimes it can stumble. And so my purpose in being here, because as I already admitted to you, and for those of you who just joined, I am a newbie. This is my first official summit that I'm fully attending. So my purpose here is to give you a few networking techniques, particularly if you are not the master of small talk, I want to send you out into the world with four new questions that you can ask that will help you get more connected to people. But first, and vastly more importantly than that, I want to introduce you to our esteemed panel. All of these beautiful people up here are very passionate about food. So in addition, in addition to me asking them to tell you who they are, where they're from, a little bit about their job, I also want them to tell you what kind of food they're passionate about, because one of the things that I noticed is as I get to know people, it's not that I can't listen to and absorb the information about them. Hi, who are you, where are you from? But if you give me one more thing, one anchoring thing, that you're interested in horseback riding or you're interested in cycling, I am more likely to remember you, and that's gonna make me better at networking with you in the future. So it's kind of like a way of anchoring who you are. So if you see me around in the halls, my other gig, which you'll find out on Twitter, is like, I like to write books. So that's what I do outside of work for fun. And so next time I see you, that might be in your mind to talk about, or at a minimum, it might help you remember me more. So with that, I will turn to my lovely panel. Tell us about you, Sheila.
My name is Sheila Sabi. I work at Comcast. I've been there for about 5 years. I've been on the OpenStack Cloud team for about 2.5 years. And that's it, really. Oh, this is my fifth summit, and I'm passionate about really all food, maybe not seafood too much, but gelato, desserts, fruits, watermelon, love watermelon.
I knew I liked her. Gelato. Okay, we're BFFs now. So Matt, tell us about you a little bit.
I'm at Time Warner Cable. I'm a principal software engineer working at OpenStack. I've been there about 2 years. I have a big software background before that. This is my fourth summit. I'm passionate really about automation and being outside. You can tell from my picture there on top of Independence Pass in Colorado. You're going to share my secret about food. So
he's internet famous about something. Tell us more about that.
So when I was in college 20 years ago now, which is kind of sad, I started a ramen website. That was back when we called things homepages. So it was called the Official Ramen Homepage. And it may still be called that, actually. It's now a blog that I don't update as much as I did when I was in college. But for a while, if you Googled for ramen, it was the top result. So I've been running that for 20 years. It's my operations experience.
Nice. Awesome. Thank you, Matt. Nikki, tell us about you.
Hi, I'm Nikki Acosta. Yes, I've been live tweeting a bit.
If you have been paying attention to social media at all during the keynotes, you have been paying attention to Nikki. So tell us more about you.
You're like, God, this girl won't shut up, huh?
Oh, no. We like you.
So my name's Nikki Acosta. I was part of the early team at Rackspace before the foundation was the foundation that worked on OpenStack. And then I left there and went to this little startup called MetaCloud, and then we got acquired 3 months later. So I'm now a part of Cisco, and I do a little podcast called OS Pod. It's the OpenStack podcast. We do like a weekly show, and we live stream it, and then we make that available on iTunes. So if you're curious about a company or, you know, any particular topic, there's probably something there that you might find useful. Oh, as for food, so every year I pay homage to the Hatch Green Chili, which is a chili that is grown in the Hatch Valley in New Mexico. And so I make everything with Hatch Green Chilies, drinks, desserts, everything has Hatch Green Chilies in it. It's good stuff.
Nice. I'm coming to your house during that season.
That
sounds great.
Send us invites.
Sure.
And you're going to be hosting us in Austin, right?
But I will. I'm
this
so excited.
This is your how many summits have you been to?
I think this is my ninth summit.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay.
It's cool to see it grow. It's most definitely, the weather here is much nicer than it was in previous years, so that's nice too.
So between us, we are representing 18 and a half summits attended. I'm half. So therefore, you guys are going to give us some good insights. I prepared a few little questions, but audience, I would like you to be thinking of questions as well, because we definitely created the space and time for you to be able to ask more specific questions of the panelists. So let's start with this idea that now that we're here, and I thank you guys all for taking some time to answer my kind of email interview that we put together in the Super User magazine and online, that implored us newbies to really prepare for the summit and plan in advance. But now we're here, it's too late to plan. So talk to me about what we can do right now to make the most of the summit. And since I started with you, Sheila, maybe I'm going to go skip over to Matt, ask him first.
For me, it is still about planning, even though we're already here. So I'm a bit of an over-planner, just as an engineer. So I typically, every morning and even at lunch, go back and review my schedule for the afternoon. And I typically have a talk I want to go to, and if it's full, I have a backup talk, and I have a list of talks I'm going to go watch on YouTube on the plane ride home, and then I tend to bounce between them. If you're here with a team from your company, it's also good to split up coverage for things. We have like 5 or 6 people here. We want to make sure, especially all the operator sessions are covered. That's really important for me. And what else is important is if there's one particular part of the cloud you're passionate about or interested in, the operator sessions that are here are a great way to go meet people. It's very informal. They're generally small rooms, pass the mic, and you can hear other people that are trying to do the same thing you're doing or having problems with the same thing you're doing. And that's the operator sessions is my favorite place to meet people.
Nice. So Nikki, tell me a little bit about what you would tell me and us as newbies to go do right now.
I wish I was as organized as you, Matt. I kind of fly by the seat of my pants. It was like 15 minutes ago. I was like, oh, where am I supposed to be? Like looking at a map.
Go.
Pace yourself and drink lots of water. You know, this year, I think there are probably fewer events, but the events that are taking place, the after hours events, are pretty large, and they usually have tons of free booze. So drink a lot of water and pace yourself. I have been guilty of losing my voice at about half of the summits, and it's a combination of probably not drinking enough water and probably yelling and talking too much.
Hardcore networking.
I know, right?
Nice. What would you say, Sheila? What do you think we should be doing now that we're here?
So download the sketch.org OpenStack application, and you can go ahead and customize your day-to-day schedule from there. It's not too late to download it now if you have to, or you can go online and set that up. But also, over-planning is great, but plan for some ad hoc time meeting and networking people, too. You might find yourself deep in a conversation with somebody that you meet over lunch, and you guys are hashing out an issue or sharing stories, and that can go on for 2 hours, and then you can meet again at another event. And those kind of relationships that are built during the summit are invaluable.
Cool. Thank you. Okay, so let's do a little exercise, and for that, I need volunteer, please. Somebody volunteer for me, please?
This guy right here in front. I volunteer that guy.
May I?
You're welcome.
Nikki, you're in trouble. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to use one of the four relationship accelerators that I brought for you. And I'm going to ask him, where are you from?
From Arcadia, California.
Ah, very good. I'm just north of you. I live near Portland, Oregon. So tell me, did you grow up and do your schooling there?
No, I didn't. Do you want to get to?
No, see, did you notice, though? He said, no, I didn't. And there was more. Okay, so I'm listening.
Tell me more. So I grew up on the East Coast in Washington, D.C., and I went to school in Chicago. Moved out to California around 2000.
Awesome. So I just learned more about him by asking, did you grow up and do your schooling there? I didn't say, where are you from? From the standpoint of, a lot of people can kind of panic because it's like, well, do you mean where I was born or where I went to school or, you know, et cetera? And it's funny because this is a weird question. It's asking a yes or no question, but it really opens the door for a lot more discussion. So I learned a lot more about him, and I might say, oh, where did you go to college? Because you said you went to college in Chicago. So which school? You grew up around Washington, D.C. Okay, tell me more about that. I have friends out there. So he gave me a lot of conversational avenues that I can pursue. And the other thing I like about that is this whole tell me more is just such an open question, and it really invites great engagement. So another question I could ask is, tell me about your current role. So that one is nice, soft, and squishy. It doesn't say, what is your title? Or even, what is your job function? It lets the person take that question and run with it in any direction they please. And so then you can follow up with a really good one. How did you come to that company or position? So let me Sheila, how did you get to your current company and position?
I was I got approached by a recruiter on LinkedIn, I think it was, or Gmail or somewhere, and they asked me if I was looking for something, and I said maybe, and then I started working there 2 weeks later.
Oh, wow. So you can follow up in a lot of directions yes. with that.
Yes.
So this is a great opportunity to, again, kind of create an open question for them. All right, here's my third favorite relationship accelerator. What's changing in your business? So is anybody willing to answer that question for me? No one wants to talk about what's changing in their business?
I'll answer it.
Oh, good, good, good. Go, Matt.
So Sheila and I are both in the cable industry. And as you probably know, cable business in the United States is generally a monopoly, but you don't have to get your TV from the cable company anymore, as most of you know. So we have a lot of competition on video. And I think for us, that's changing how we look at things, where we spend money, and you know, are we willing to wait 6 months or 2 years to release software anymore? We have to be way more agile and way quicker. That's one of the reasons we're doing OpenStack. That's a big change we have.
So he has just told me something about how the industry is changing, and now the obvious follow along is how does that impact your role? And especially being here at the conference, I'm gonna learn a lot from Matt by finding out how his role is changing and probably about how your role is changing as a result of the changes in the industry. So, cool. All right, let's do one more, Relationship Accelerator. What did you think of the last session you attended? Can I ask anyone? Anyone brave? Oh, yeah. Tell me.
So I accidentally lunched with Tobias Ford. I sat at a table with no directors there, and then he turned up, and he was the guy. And it was fantastic. He works for AT&T. He's got huge scale issues. They're ahead of where we are. So, you know, I'm glad I did it. It was just a space to have lunch, and then turned out to be the best personal relationship I made so far at any of the conferences. So.
What a cool and fortuitous connection. That's great, thank you. So now I might ask you, what's on your schedule coming up? And then that gives me an opportunity to also kind of maybe reevaluate and rethink my schedule. Okay, four questions. Does anybody see something they could use tonight or at a future session? Yes, okay. My job here is done. I'm gonna go take the rest of the session off. Y'all are next. How do we get more involved in the community here and after Summit? Give me some direction.
Let me
start with you, Nikki.
Who's on Twitter? Who's not on Twitter? So Twitter is where all the cloud people hang out. All the tech people. That's where you actually get to communicate with people that you would probably never talk to in real life. I have a small admission. I shouldn't say this on camera. Tim Bell from CERN is my ultimate geek crush, so much so that I brought him a bottle of wine from California, because he's in CERN, which they have great wine in that part of the world, so I'm not sure why I brought him wine, but I've met a lot of really great people and followed a lot of really great topics because of Twitter, and it's a good way to just reach out and connect to people. I used to use this little tool called TweetDeck, and so you can set up a column that says, show me every tweet that has the word OpenStack in it. Mm-hmm. And so over time, you can start seeing which articles start to trend or which announcements start to trend. It's just a really good way to get instant feedback from people. If you have a question or if you want to know where to go or what to do at a summit, there's always someone on Twitter who's listening. And so it's a good way to communicate without having to know a phone number or an email address. So if you're not in social media, I would highly encourage you to use that as a tool. If you're in sales and you want to know what your customers are doing, I'm sure, Matt, you probably get on Twitter and talk about what you're doing at work all the time. It's a good way to find out kind of where your customer's at, who the right people are to talk to, and who are the right people to engage with and learn from.
Right on.
And just one thing to add, you use the hashtags that they provide for the summit. So this summit, for example, is We Are OpenStack. If somebody has TweetDeck set up for that, they'll find you. You can find them. You guys can connect.
Yeah. Matt, what do you think? How can we get more involved in the community?
I'm definitely on board with Twitter, but I'll give you a couple other ones too.
Yeah.
The community is really important to me. Before this, I worked at Canonical on Ubuntu, which is very community-based. And the biggest takeaway is that if you contribute, and that could just be us starting a discussion on the mailing list or even asking a question or going to an IRC meeting, any kind of contribution, even in that way, is is like a currency in a community like that. So you contribute, you put something in, and you'll be able to get something out. That's also part of meeting people here. You're much more likely to get someone to answer your question who you've had a beer with or had a coffee with or shook hands with them across the table.
I know that to be true. Yeah. I've seen that happen, yeah.
It was definitely true even at my job at Canonical, where everyone was spread out. It was way better to meet people, and then you had a connection with them. It's pretty faceless on IRC or on email. So, yeah.
Cool.
Speaking of IRC, the mailing list, too, are really, really great. There's a mailing list pretty much for everything under the sun. Like, women of OpenStack have a mailing list.
Yep.
Various projects have their own mailing list. And the operators, IRC meetings are great. Mm-hmm. Operators, the working groups that are here. You know, if you're in the telco or enterprise, or if you're an operator, there's specific people who are in those groups that probably share a lot of the same challenges and concerns that you have. And so that's a great way to come together every 6 months and actually get stuff done.
Yeah.
The other thing I would encourage people to do, if you think you can, is to make a contribution back that actually goes through the whole process of how OpenStack works through the code review process. And it doesn't have to be code. I guarantee you will find a problem in the documentation if you look. Mm-hmm. You go in there, you download the docs, you change a few sentences, you push it up, you follow through the process, and you see how OpenStack is created. And I felt that was very powerful for me to do in the very beginning. And it is not always the most fun process, because you might have to discuss with people the right terminology if it's a doc change, that kind of thing. But I always thought that was very important. So I always try to get ATC by doing at least one change. It's usually way more than that now, but I think everyone should try to do that.
Yeah. Actually, I'm going to try that. I'm a non-technical person, but I was just talking to Lana Brenly, who runs our docs project, a little while ago, and I'm telling her, okay, lady, I'm on the hook for getting an ATC from doing some docs contribution.
Developers are always, you know, docs is kind of always the last thing on a developer's mind, so there's always work to do there. So. Cool.
Great.
Lots of spelling errors. Is that what you're saying?
All kinds of
spelling errors
stuff.
And incomplete sentences.
And ask.openstack.org too. You can go there and answer some questions.
Oh yeah, that's good.
Yep.
Okay. Cool. Well, I want to give us some time to get questions from you folks. I have to run the mic toward you so we can hear you answer or ask questions. But I want to know, what do you want to know from the panelists? And these were just some example ideas, the professional development tips, sessions coming up, how to get involved more specifically with projects or work groups or resources. So would you raise your hand, and I will come to you and find out what do you want to know? Yeah.
Great sessions coming up. I didn't plan as well as Matt maybe suggested.
What do you guys suggest? What are you looking forward to?
It really is going to depend on what you want to learn about, but I'll tell you that my colleague's going to give a great upgrades talk tomorrow. If you're running OpenStack now already and you haven't upgraded it before, that's going to be a very valuable talk. It'll be a for Kilo, not for Liberty. That's going to be a great talk, and I'm looking forward to some of the Keystone talks, because that's an area I focus on. But those are maybe specific to what I want to get out of it. So,
cool, good. Who's got another question?
Doing user sessions, so there's a user panel. Is my mic on?
Yes, you're on, Nikki.
There's a user panel with PayPal, Deutsche Telekom, and Workday, and they're all at sort of various stages of OpenStack adoption, but they're folks that are really transparent about their sort of journey through OpenStack. And I think one thing that you'll learn from folks like this is that, you know, the technology shift is actually a really small part of OpenStack adoption. A lot of what companies are being challenged to do is actually change their culture in the process. And I think it's one of the parts that's probably most often overlooked, because you think OpenStack, OpenStack software, like it's just a technology shift. And it really isn't. It's a cultural shift. I mean, the days of, you know, submitting tickets to get a virtual machine are coming to an end. People want self-service access to resources. You know, we're a generation that doesn't want to wait for things. We want it right now. And so there's a lot of really cool things that OpenStack is helping to drive, and that's part of what I want to dig into in this session, because I think it's one area where I think a lot of companies, especially in the enterprise, are doing it wrong. You know, you got to change your culture. If you don't change your culture and you just try to take OpenStack and force it and try to apply your old way of doing things, it's not going to be a positive experience.
That's true. That's the hardest part for us, too, is the culture, cultural change.
Yeah. I'm going to the talk by Ann Gentle from Rackspace.
She's so
about
great.
Using personal medical data from type 1 diabetes and aggregating that with OpenStack. I'm looking for another couple questions. Yes, sir. Just a minute. Let me get this to you.
Hello. I'm interested in involvement into working groups, mostly here on Summit, not in projects.
Yeah, there's some really great working groups, and they all have sort of, I think they all have like formal sessions, most of them do anyway. The product working group just released today the roadmap for OpenStack, and they're trying to get a little bit more crisp and trying to convey that roadmap. During the keynote, you probably saw some of the work that's being done with the Project Navigator that helps companies kind of look at the whole landscape of all the projects that are happening and try to give users and adopters and operators a sense of which projects are mature and ready to be sort of deployed at scale, and then which projects are kind of new and investigative. And if you are risk averse, then you know you may not want to adopt projects that are still brand new. You might want to wait a little bit for those to mature. You may want to contribute to them to try to make them better. So the product working group is pretty great. There's some folks here that are involved. If you just go on Twitter and look up product working group, I'm sure you'll see
a
ton of tweets. Yeah, the product working group is great. Cool. Never before have I seen an open source project that has such an awesome roadmap for an open source project. It's a really cool thing that they're doing.
And I think they have a mailing list as well.
They do have a mailing list.
You can join the mailing list and find out where they're meeting up and go sit at the fishbowl sessions.
Yes, and they're all open and they're published on the schedule, so I know you'd be welcome. I've got time for one more question of the panel. Smart people? Yes, sir, just a minute.
As you were referring to the smart people, I'm sure you were talking about the people up here. I am here for the non-coding working groups and was wondering what your thoughts were. I'm gonna be involved in the app ecosystem working group. It's been fallow for some time, and so I'm working with Tom Feifeld to get that some momentum. What would you suggest as far as my best experience, not being a coder or a technical person per se, in my best use of this summit?
So where do you go to hang out with the pointy-haired business dude? Is that what you're asking? Just joking.
No, I actually think John wants to play. He wants to get his hands dirty.
It's a really good question. So the marketplace booths, you can usually in the booths there's like one technical person and then one sort of business person. And the app ecosystem, as you know, is growing like crazy. In fact, most of the startups that started developing sort of core infrastructure as a service platforms have all been, for the most part, they've all been acquired at this point. And what we're starting to see is momentum happening above the stack in terms of the ecosystem that plays there. So I would visit the marketplace and talk to some of those folks there and find out what sessions are going on. It seems like there's a pretty good balance in the schedule between technical sessions and non-technical sessions. And even some of the technical sessions that I've been to, people are pretty willing to answer questions that are non-technical in nature.
But you should probably be, I'm trying to figure out the best way to say this, but a little careful about going to some of the design sessions where my first summit, I went to a bunch of Keystone design sessions, and those are very deep, very fast. It's discussions they've already been doing for 6 months. They're already like looking through code, and those aren't the sessions you want to go to and ask a basic Keystone question to. Those are sessions where they're planning their work for the next 6 months. So if you go to a design session and you're possibly in over your head or maybe in the wrong room, it just know it's not the place to ask a how does Keystone work kind of question. That may be a little different than the product working group kind of things you're discussing. But just a caution, because this is essentially two summits right now. I will encourage you to come hang out the operators sessions, which I'm a big fan of. I feel like even if you're new, you can pick up stuff from there. You'll hear us complaining about things that are going to cause you problems, like RabbitMQ, and you'll know when you go back, I've got to worry about this thing called RabbitMQ. So,
did you want anything, Sheila?
Yeah. To his point, go to the main sessions are probably really good. Mm-hmm. For that.
Yeah. And speaking as a non-technical person, I'm going to work group after work group and getting my hands dirty and not really attending Design Summit, but definitely in the weeds at the user committee for the product work group, at the diversity work group, at the marketing meeting. So there's lots on the calendar for those of us who can count binary on our fingers, but not much more.
If you're interested in the app space too, there's a lot of attention right now, obviously around Docker and Kubernetes. Any talks that you can go to that are kind of talking about those topics in particular, you know, there's this sort of thread happening where people are saying, are these technologies a threat to OpenStack? Do we play nice with OpenStack? But fact of the matter is, there's a lot of adoption happening above the stack with platform as a service and some of the containerization tech. So I would definitely hit some of those sessions, because I think they're fundamentally, over time, they're going to change the way that people think about developing apps and deploying apps at scale.
Great. Thank you. Well, one of the things that I find when I'm at a really big event is that I tend to gravitate toward people who look like me. So women in their 30s who are white and who speak English seem to be the easiest people for me to talk to. So one of the things I try to do is play a little game in my head that forces me out of that comfort zone so that I'm talking to people who do not look like me or who do not think like me, so that I'm talking to people who code, for example. And so one of the things that I like to do is say, okay, who am I going to approach? I'm going to approach everyone with an OpenStack t-shirt. If I see you're wearing an OpenStack t-shirt, you're going to get said hi to by me. And I make it as simple as, hi, I'm Heidi Joy. This is my first summit. I work with the foundation. I'm brand new. Tell me about what you do here. And really emphasizing the fact that I'm new usually gets me some points, kind of like back in the old days when I was a waitress, I would tell people I would be new. They forgive a lot more, and they're also generally a lot nicer. So you could play a game in your head. You could say, everyone carrying a backpack, everyone wearing orange, everyone sitting or standing next to me, like if you're waiting in line for something, force yourself out of your comfort zone to not just talk to people who look like you or seem to think like you or who happen to maybe do the same thing that you do. And so one of the things I wanted to give you before you leave today is we have some fun little smiley face buttons that will help you kind of notice each other as you're walking around the summit. And I'd like you to take two or three of them and give them to fellow newbies that you meet. I'm putting mine right here on my name tag. And if I see any of you wearing these, I'm going to make sure that I come up to you and say hi to you. So I'm going to pass those out. And this is my TLDR for the who should I meet, who should I approach, which is everyone. So I'm going to ask you nicely to pass that around. I'll give you one to pass kind of toward down the middle. And we've got another one over here for the right-hand side. Final thoughts, you guys. Sheila, I'm going to start with you.
Good luck. Have fun. Make the most of it. It can get really, really overwhelming. Your day will be jam-packed.
It can get really overwhelming. Just hang in there, drink the water, as Nikki mentioned earlier. Get some rest and just have fun. Have a really good time.
I'm having fun so far already.
Me too.
Yeah.
I'm having a blast.
Matt, what do you think?
I'm actually going to just echo something Sheila said, because I said I do like to plan everything a little bit too much, but you can always watch a talk on YouTube if you're in the middle of a conversation with someone that's going to be more valuable to you. Watch it on YouTube on the plane, right?
Yeah.
You can't recreate the in-person conversation on the plane, probably. So.
Cool. Nikki, what do you think?
OpenStack has grown so much. I mean, I still have my old Piston t-shirt where it had the five core projects on it, and now it is so massive that not one person can be an expert in everything. And so use this time to meet new people. There's always a tendency when you go to these things to hang out with people that you work with, because those are the people that you probably know the best. But step outside of your comfort zone and meet new people. And it's cool. Once you start attending summits, you'll start to see a lot of the same people and meet all kinds of new people. I work at Cisco. There's like 70,000 employees. And every time I come to one of these things, the last two, I've met a bunch of people that work for the same company that I didn't know. So. Definitely try to branch out and have a good time. Go to the parties, like, you know, meet a bunch of new people and keep in touch. Follow people on Twitter so you can keep those conversations going long after the summit's ended.
Yeah. So I wanted a show of hands. Who's going to a party tonight? Oh, come on. They should all be up. All right. Well, I'm going to be looking for your smiley faces. I also sent out a note to the entire OpenStack Foundation staff asking them to make a special effort
to meet you and greet you, knowing that you're wearing the smiley face button. So if you took a few for some friends who are new, I hope you do. I hope you pass them out. It makes you just that much more accessible. I was just going to add, when I go to the parties, even though it's totally annoying, I wear my name tag.
Yep.
Because I really want people to feel like I am accessible, that I'm easy to meet. And my first name, Heidi Joy, is kind of like, it's a little strange because it's two words, one name. So by having the name tag, it just kind of helps reinforce, or for somebody maybe who's a non-native English speaker, it might be a little bit easier to kind of read and absorb. So it might be helpful for you to wear your name tag. I also try to make sure I carry a nice handful of business cards.
So Heidi, before we go, I read that you write romance novels.
Yes, I do.
And do you write them under your own name?
I do.
You do?
It was a terrible idea.
I'm gonna stalk you after this to check out your novels.
Oh my goodness. I'm in so
romance novels.
No. Yes. Hey, we all have something we're passionate about.
Go, Heidi.
It could have been horseback riding.
So
cool. Well, I want to say thank you, first of all, to all the panelists, Sheila, Matt, and Nikki. You guys are the bomb. I'm so glad I got to meet all of you this time. And thank you for joining in. So we're going to wrap this up just a little early so you can either race to a new session, meet somebody else in this room, or come up and say hi to us and ask us questions. So thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.